Okay, so here we are again. I had to restart the stream for some reason. I lost connection, or OBS lost connection. So let's see if we are back live and whether everything works now. So yeah, let's just start playing, and I hope everything works out. At least I see myself streaming, so it should be fine. Okay, so thanks again for sticking with me through the further technical difficulties, and I suspend a Riftbolt, say go, and hope there I'm on some kind of combo deck that doesn't go off turn one and our Eidolon does some heavy lifting. So. Okay, I guess the combo deck part turned out fine, but looks like we are going to have a very quick game one. I think the technical difficulties might have been longer than our entire match, because we're playing against all spells. For those of you who don't know this deck, it is a deck that is basically a turn one combo deck, which works by bringing back Under City Informer, or Ballast, or bring into play Under City Informer and Ballast Spy, which will mill your entire deck since you have no lands. You get four Nacromebius, you flashback Gravity Turn, you get Thassa's Oracle, and you win since you don't have any cards in your library anymore. Okay, that was a fun game one. Let's do some sideboarding, and as always, it's kind of a little bit of a, well, meta choice what to bring in, since there are different hate pieces like Roiling Vortex, Leyland of the Void, or Surgical Extraction, which might hit them, but on the other hand, this kind of combo deck is able to sideboard into another build with Charbelcher and Lion's Eye Diamonds. That's why I bring in Roiling Vortex and the like, and probably cut Exquisite Firecraft and Price of Progress since they don't really do too much. They play those flip lands from Battle from Zendikar, but they almost always don't have more than one land in play anyway. We have one more cut to make. I guess we could maybe cut one Roiling Vortex, because I think it isn't too good, and let's keep in ley lines and surgicals. Are we going to bring Smash to Smarines to, I guess we can also bring in some Smash in case they are on the Charbelcher plan. Let's try this and see whether it works out. Okay, I think this is just not enough since they have kind of an 80% win percentage on turn one, and playing Goblin Guide just won't cut it, so I think we have to have some kind of disruption, otherwise we will just get comboed out, no matter whether they are on the All Spells or Charbelcher plan here. So even if this otherwise is a great hand, I don't think I can keep it. This is something I will consider keeping, at least, because it has a lot of turn 3 potential. The Goblin Guide will deal 6 damage over 3 turns. Those are 10 additional damage, so we don't only have to get in 4 more. We also have the Roiling Vortex if we want it. Let's see whether they mulligan first, I guess. And if they mulligan, maybe I keep it in hope of, if they keep a 7 cut head, I don't think the turn 1 Goblin Guide, turn 2 Roiling Vortex. Well, yeah, I think I'll mulligan. And yes. By now, I think I'm committed. I'm not going to be fast enough with this kind of hand, so I hope for a ley line at some point. So, yeah. And, well, I think we can concede also. Maybe it is correct to keep a hand at some point there, but I think that all the hands wouldn't be fast enough against their 7 card hands, against the 7 card hand they would keep. So I thought mulliganing for some kind of disruption was mandatory. Maybe the six card hand was good enough, but well, let's try in match two. Okay, so we're on the draw, and I think this is a hand I'm going to keep because we have the turn one creature, which is very important. We have Fire Blast, we have a lot of late game potential, so if we are up against some kind of controlling deck, we have a lot of late game power, and if we draw our second land, we are off to the races, so I think that's fine enough. Turn one polluted delta, no play, could be pretty much anything. Attack with the Sword Spear for 1 point of damage. Connects, so they don't have a removal spell, which is great if they are some kind of fair deck. Basic Swamp. Entomb. Okay, this might be a quick second match as well if you are up against Reanimator, which it seems like we are. And we probably don't do too much against turn 2 Grizzlebrand, but maybe we get in Bolt plus Fire Blast or do something about that. Unfortunately, we are also getting unmasked. Fortunately, we have two Fire Blasts. But yeah, I don't think there is. If they have that turn to Exhume or something like that, that can get us out of the spot because we first have to draw a land and then we have to draw a burn spell, and by then we. Yeah. Probably don't have enough. But let's try. Game one, well, match one was quick enough, so I don't think we are in too much of a hurry here. Yeah. Smart pick by our opponent to take the Rift Bolt, because Rift Bolt was the one way we could probably get rid of the Grizzlebrand at some point. I think here I'm just going to Lava Spike them because there's not much of an advantage. Well, we could also play the Goblin Guide. Oh, let's play the Goblin Guide, but I don't think it makes too much of a difference. Okay, we found the mountain, so what now? This turn we can o only play Lava Spikes and Fire Blasts anyway, and since we can't kill the Grizzlebrand, I guess we might as well Lava Spikes them, put them to 11. This was, by the way, the point or the reason why I played the Goblin Guide, because now we attack with an additional Prowess trigger. Not that it probably will matter. If we attack now, we put them down to 6 and maybe they'll fetch and we can Fire Blast them. Yeah, I think we kind of have a shot here, right? Because we attack now, attack them down to 6. Unfortunately, the other line would have them exactly at 1 with the Fire Blast, so I think that's not worth it. But if we draw a land now, we can 8 them, which is 10 with the Swift Sweep triggers, which is would be exactly 13. And maybe they will fetch another time here. So I think we might actually have a chance of getting them. But let's see. Of course, if they have anything, it's probably not enough, but maybe. So land is lethal, right? That's not a land, unfortunately, so I think that's just not enough, right? Because it's Yeah, it's like 6'10". See if we can have a look at another interesting card, but I don't think so. Okay, they're fetching. So, is there any way? Well, there's no harm in trying, I guess. Apart from showing them that Fire Blast is a card they might consider, but I think by now most players know anyway. Hi, Armin. You already missed match one. We lost in quick fashion to all spells. The first game was a turn one kill, and the second time I mulliganed for Graveyard Hate and never got anything down to one card. Maybe I should have kept six, but I think we would have lost this game because they kept seven, and this mostly means they have some kind of combo. Now we are down a game against Reanimator in a very close game, which we could have won if we drawn the land, the third land in the right spot, because they had Grizzlebrand reanimate, but we had some kind of pressure, and I think. You saw the first match as well. I think, well, to be fair, this was closer than I thought. After turn two Grizzlebrand, we kind of got there. So let's bring in the ley lines. Let's bring in Incinerating Bridge and Surgical. And what to cut? I think Price of Progress isn't too good, especially since they indicated that they are willing to fetch for basics. So I guess Roiling Vortex also doesn't do too much, right? It hits on the one hand, it hits Unmask and Lotus Petal, but is that really a thing? Or, well, on the other hand, Exquisite Firecrop also is really slow. Okay. I think I will cut at least two Firecrafts, and yeah, maybe a third Exquisite Firecraft or the Roiling Vortex. I think the Vortex has some kind of potential to get them. Yeah, let's split it, one Vortex, one Firecraft, and let's see how that goes. Okay. We're not here not to keep that, and maybe we lose to Stronghold Gambit or whatever, but this is as fine as it gets. So put those ley lines in play. Hope that is enough. Chancellor of the Annex is fine by me. This is really Riftbolt works out great against Chancellor of the Annex because that way we can trigger it and pay for a spell, and then by turn three we can play the Eidolon. Well, in theory we could have. So nobody got anything, huh? So we have to make sure to pay this one mana down to 15. Okay. So I hope we can do anything before they hard cast their stuff or play Pack Rat or whatever is their plan against Leyland of the Void. Or they reanimate my Eidolon. Okay, cool. That's fine. I guess if they want to trade some damage, and I hope that in the next couple of turns I'm able to draw some spells which will be enough to put them down to zero from 13, which is not too much. The Eidolon also taxes them, Well, by now we lose the race at the no at the moment, but I hope that we can draw something relevant. Down to 14. Guess that's kind of relevant because if we keep drawing some small burn spells, we will also win the race. Then down to 7. So haha, we only have bad spells. Okay, I'm kind of getting worried. If we top deck another couple of lands, we might just lose to our own Eidolon here. But, well, if we now draw one burn spell, they can't play anything. So, I think single burn spell will be fine. Eidolon is also okay. Because now we are winning the race, they are down to 5, we are down. They really can't attack us and they can't cast a spell really. Apart from something like Force of Vigor. So, phew. Yeah, if he wins with Eidolon, he totally deserved it. But in the end, turn 7, we got to stabilize against the turn 2 Eidolon. Or turn 3 Eidolon, I don't remember exactly what it was. But yeah, let's try again and hope to get them. It seems like they could be on mono black reanimator, right? Because I didn't see any duels in any of the games so far. It also might be that they're just very careful. But I don't think that changes much about how we play. This is totally fine. We got our ley line of the void, we got our two critters, we have our Ensnaring Bridge. If they deal somehow with the ley line, which I guess in mono black should be very hard, but again, it isn't given that they are mono black. Chancellor of the Annex is again fine by me. Okay, no play. So I'm going to suspend the Rift Pool again so the Chancellor doesn't get any value. But what is their plan? What's their plan to discard and Lotus Petal reanimate, or am I missing something? Yeah, hard cast plan if it's mono black, but no lands is a bad start for a hard cast plan, I would say. I'm confused. But maybe they are as well. So I think it's looking pretty good. I don't see what is getting them out of this situation. And we have some kind of pressure. They will get one or two more turns, but not too much, I guess, if we draw another land. Excess Firecraft plus Rift Bolt is like 7, 11, 13. So. Okay, so they are not on. Okay, now I'm scared. It's not mono black. Yeah, this. So, look good. They didn't play anything for the first three turns, but we might lose if they have a reanimation and we don't draw a third land. That's pretty dicey situation. At least we can draw a third land for the Ensnaring Bridge, which might not be good enough if they have some kind of green artifact removal. On the other hand, they don't seem to have a Lotus Petal, which It's good news. And mountain would be enough. Fire blast also should be enough, right? Is there anything we have to consider? I don't think so. If we had got by whatever, pyrokinesis or so be it. But I think that's... Yeah. Yeah, sure. Cool. One match against Reanimator, which is kind of hard in general, because they almost always win game one, which they did, but in very close fashion against us. And but to be fair, in games two and three, we had pretty reasonable hands with lots of ley lines and other stuff. All the bad luck we had in match one, Mulligan won without seeing any ley line or surgical, which is really unlikely. I can't remember, but I figured out the probability at one time, and yeah, it's really low. Basically, it's like 40% or about 40% to have a 4 off in your starting hand, and if you have 5, it increases further. And for you to have 7 times in a row, none of it was pretty harsh. But I guess if we take one match against Reanimator and lose one match to all spells, which we would probably have lost, even if we have won game two, because they are just so good at killing us on turn one. Yeah, so off to a good start, off to a fast start as well. Two matches in 24 minutes. Let's see how it continues from here on. Yeah, so I didn't play too much Legacy since Strixhaven came out. I was mainly drafting and playing Limited. Played like, I think, 2 leagues or so, which went fine, but I didn't see too many new cards. By the way, I'm definitely keeping this, hoping for a second land and firing up all the burn spells with our prowess triggers. So I didn't see too many new cards. I got owned by the new Liliana at one point against a, I don't know, 4 or 5 color control deck. Oh, this is Dredge. Yeah, getting the premium matchups right now. Yeah, combo tone all the way today. I see. But no Dredger, seems fine. Maybe we got a shot if we draw a couple of lands. That's the first one. Yeah, but what I was about to say is, of course, Liliana. If Liliana sticks with the Magecraft Drain to Life, makes short work of burn in no time. But yeah, you have to get to the point. I haven't seen the new combo deck with Witherbloom Apprentice and whatever the other smog card is, which is the kind of infinite combo, because Witherbloom Apprentice triggers on Magecraft, which means also when a spell gets copied and the other spell has the option to copy it by discarding, but you have to discard 2 cards, and then you can do infinite copies. Okay. Do they still don't have a Dredger? Okay. That's pretty unlucky. I think maybe if we draw land, we can just be faster than them, right? It's like 15 points of damage. So if I suspend Riftbolt, I chain lightning them, they go to 13, go down to 12, and next turn I have, yeah, but no, they still don't have any dredgers. What is going on? I'm so confused. Yeah, Chain of Smog combo. Yeah, I don't think it's a problem for burn too. I guess I'm just hoping they don't have Cable Therapy as well. they were really relying on this careful study turn one, right? Because now I kill them if they don't have anything. It doesn't seem like they have a dredger. They can bring back an Ikarit, which will get them a token, but I have 12 points of burn in hand. So we have to sweat the single draw step and then we kill them, game one. Wow, that's... That went differently than expected. Yeah, that's true. I should have split the balls right there. That's fair. So, okay, we win game one, and we have. I feel very good about having. Two games to make my bunch of graveyard hate work. The question is Insane Bridge something I'm interested in? I haven't seen too much of what kind of other combo kills they might include. But I think I'm not too much in need of Ensnaring Bridge, am I? On the other hand, it's just Roiling Vortex also doesn't do too much. Thanks to all the seven people watching the stream right now. Nice to have you here. Yeah, do I want Ensnaring Bridge? I think I just hope that it is a possibility to steal a game, and I think that's something I'm interested in. I also want to be pretty fast. Yeah, maybe cut a lava spike or something. Okay, let's try while we are at 61 cards. Sorry, I. Was too slow to put a to cut another lava spike after clicking submit accidentally. So, is this enough? I don't think so. I mean, if we can surgical the Ikarits, the deck really doesn't do too much. But on the other hand, we don't have. Really don't have anything, and if they have some kind of therapy or other engine going on and can get rid of the surgical somehow, I just lose. Yeah, I think I'm looking for a better hand. If it was like functional otherwise, I would guess I keep it, but without anything, yeah, that's much better. We have the surgical again, and we also have tons of action. I think I'll put back the price and let's see how it goes. Leyline of Sanctity. Okay, that makes me feel a little bit bad to get rid of the price. Okay, couple therapy. Nice, nice. Okay, they target themselves. Naming Grave Troll. Okay. So the question now is, do we want to get rid of the Grave Troll already, or do we want to wait for them I have to admit, I don't have too much experience playing Surgical Extraction because normally I just rely on the four ley lines. So I don't think I have ever played against Dredge with Surgical Extraction in my deck. So how does it work? If we wait for Ikaruts to show up and then we remove the Ikaruts, what does the deck do then? Well, they can also generate a bunch of zombies just with Narcomoebas and what's it called? And Narcomoebas and Bridge from Below and Carbotherapy and so on. And they don't have really anything in hand right now. They have Narcomoeba and Stinkweed Imp, which they can't discard, so I think I'm just going for it. And I have to figure out how that works. Okay, if I do it now, I should have done it, of course, to trigger Monastery Swift Spear. So. Want to remove it from the graveyard as well. Did I remove it from the graveyard? Hand? Library? How do I remove it from the graveyard? Oh, it is removed from the graveyard, I think. I hope. So, Carbotherapy is the only card in the graveyard, which seems fine. This is a revealed card zone. X4 and XL seems fine. Okay. Yeah. Thanks for sticking through my first surgical extraction. Maybe my first surgical extraction of on Magic Online ever. Yeah, that's a card you can mess up with, definitely. Okay, hard cast Narcomoeba, sure. Think I'm just bolting it if I don't draw a second land, because my bolts really don't have any targets after ley line. And let's see if we can. Yeah, clock increases. Yeah, now I'm really missing the one point from the surgical extraction, right? Because it changes the clock, probably, or maybe. Depending on how much damage they take from their mana confluence and their City of Brass. Ooh. Breaks through, of course. It's a little bit annoying because now they get started with their shenanigans. They go to 9, go down to 3. No, don't go down to 3, go down to 6. And we can add 3 possible points of damage by hitting ourselves with Lightning Bolt and Fire Blast. So, but that's just not enough, right? So that's 6. Yeah, that's not enough. But let's see what we can draw. Maybe another creature would be fine. Price of Force would be really good. So, do we want to Lava Spike? I think I have to like delete those messages somehow. There should be a I'll figure that out after the match. Because I don't want to become famous. Okay, so, but the question is, the lava spike to my face deals 5 to me, I go down to 13, but they go down to, I think I want to keep all the bowls. I think I'm just attacking here and keeping up the bowls for potential Icarids or whatever to get rid of the bridges. And then next turn I can lava spike myself if I want to. So, do I want to bowl the Icarid right now? I think I can, because then they don't get a zombie token in case they would have a bridge from below. And I don't have anything else to do with the board right now anyway. Bye bye, Icarid. So, still no bridges, right? But a Hogak, okay. I think I might keep up Lightning Bolt. Okay, of course, now I wish I lava spiked myself last turn. But it seems like we could be getting away with it, because I still don't have any bridges, if I see correctly. And furthermore, they don't have a possibility to bring back Hogak right now, and yeah, if we both the Nakramibu right now, that should be game. Cool. So we won against Dredge. Also, matchup that really depends on our Graveyard Hate doing the job, which it did in game 2 and in game 1. We just lucked out a little bit because they didn't draw anything. So now, how do I block this? Yeah, I think I got it. Cool. I'm very pleased with the start, because three combo decks are really what you don't want to meet with burn, because combo historically is combo decks are really bad matchups. And therefore, being 2-1 is totally fine. Also, it really strengthens my opinion on having a lot of graveyard hate in your sideboard right now, because as you can see, all the three combo decks we met today all interact with the graveyard, and Leyline of the Void is just really good against them. And yeah, that's why I'm a big fan of the card. Of course, there are different options like Relic or Surgical. Yeah, so let's see what our round 4 opponent is up to. Might be a real quick league, because we're already in match 4 and we only play for about 40 minutes. Okay, I think that's fine. We have a lot of gas. We don't have a turn 1 creature, but we have a Fire Blast if we ever draw a second land. If we just hit land drops, the hand is totally fine. We have like 9, 13, 17 points of burn. We have rolling vortex, so we basically only have to draw lands and maybe one or two spells. And if I want to rely on drawing something with burn, I think it's lands, because in fair matchups you often enough have the time to draw into your land at some point. And it's much worse if you have if you keep a hand with like three or four lands and draw a couple of lands than the other way around. So I think it's a hand I would keep. And yeah, start with Riftbolt because it's important to get the Riftbolt out of a hand before we deploy our Roiling Vortex. Yeah, and then let's see how it develops with a hand with so many resources. I'm also very tempted if they play some kind of Delver or something like that to point the Riftbolt at the Delver, because we have lots of resources and yeah, the bottleneck is the lands we have. So we want to like trade a little bit of resources and develop our board further, I think, at least. That's how I would approach that. Turn one Swamp. Turn one Thoughtseize. This is another combo deck or some kind of, yeah, could be lots of things. Could be also some kind of shadow variant, or also could be Pox or something like that, which as I pointed out last time or the time before that, I've seen pretty often. But seems like we are up against a combo deck, most likely some kind of storm variant. Yeah, probably gonna lose this game because we are not very fast, and Storm tends to kill like l mostly by turn 3 at the latest. Okay, so if we attack now, we put them down to 10. If we play Roiling Vortex, they'll go down to 9. And then, if we get another turn, which is what we have to hope for, they go down to. They take 2 from the Goblin Guide again, so they go down to 7. We point both burn spells at them, and the Roiling Vortex will finish them off. So, either way, if our opponent doesn't any do anything, we have lethal by our turn 4, or, well, technically the upkeep of their turn 5. So I think it's worth it here to play Roiling Vortex. It's worse against Ad Nauseam in particular, but yeah. If they go the Ad Nauseam route, they might also need to play other zero CMC spells as well. So let's see what the other line is putting them to 4. And then we might not have lethal next turn, but we probably will also have, because they either fetch, or if we can draw a land, we can draw another burn spell. Chain Lightning also bears the risk of getting rid of our Goblin Guide, which might give them another turn. After all, I think I'm going to cast Roiling Vortex and hope for the best. Yeah, this might be Tess. This was what I was thinking, that's why I phrased it Storm Variant, because A&T, in my experience, doesn't play too much Thoughtseizes, but there are some players who still do, maybe also as a one-off. I also played against Tess the other day. Okay. That's also a reason for having gone the other line, I guess, because the other line is much more deadly. Yeah, but I think Lava Spike should be fine if they don't have abrupt decay or something. And even abrupt decay probably doesn't do it. Yeah, okay, cool. So we still don't really know what we're up against, but I think the rest makes me think it's ANT. We also didn't see any red cards or so, so I think we're up against ANT, which we will bring in the vortexes. I also tend to or liked some amount of ley lines of the void because so let's see. I think we are going to cut Exquisite Firecraft and maybe Price of Progress. And the question is how many ley lines do we want to bring in? Because their deck relies pretty much on the graveyard with Pass and Flames lines and so on. So on the other hand, we all still have four Eidolons and four Roiling Vortex, so I don't might not be on too many ley lines. Yeah, I think after all, Exquisite Firecraft and Price of Progress are so low impact or so expensive in case of Exquisite Firecraft that I want all the hate I can get. Okay, chat is also voting for four ley lines, so I guess that's where we're at. So I think that's fine. We have lots of hate if we can get to stick our hate pieces. We also have a turn one creature. Okay, that's just weird. Okay. So they are on the Whistlebloom combo deck, I guess. So we can't do anything in their turn, so we hope to go for them faster. And hope they don't have Whistlebloom Apprentice and Chain of Smog. I guess our sideboarding didn't do us too much good in that case. But can't have it all, right? Unfortunately, this doesn't say copies, cast or copy a spell, otherwise, it would be, of course, pretty good in other t situations too, but especially in this situation, so I think we're going to Eidolon here just to put more pressure on them. Yeah, our opponent might have been brewing up some sort of list, but what r did we really see game one? We saw LED, but how does LED work with Chain of Smogs and Chain of Smog and what the other thing called the Bloom Apprentice? Nice. We have another one where that came from. I think we're in a pretty good spot because it doesn't seem they are comboing too soon. We have an Eidolon in play. But you never know. Right? There could be Lotus Petal and Apprentice and yeah, but that my friend might be a little bit slow, so how are they dead already? Four, five. They're dead in their upkeep, right? Or did I miscount? Okay, cool. Combo day continues. some kind of storm with a bloom apprentice pile, probably. Maybe some storm or other LED synergies. 3-1. Let's see if we meet our fifth combo deck to round out the day or how it goes. 3-1, off to a pretty good start, and let's see how it continues. So, let's wait for our round 5 opponent. Pretty weird league today, to be honest, because in my experience, there are still a lot of fair decks like Uropiles and different flavors of Delva, whether it be Grixis, UR, or Ruck. But probably we get Turbo Depth right now if I had to estimate by the opponents we've met so far. Yeah, same reasoning as last. As in the game 1 against Dredge, we have the first sphere, we have the suite of 1 mana burn spells, we have the top end, we just hope to draw some lands and be fine. Okay, we got a Delva deck indeed. I think I'm going to run out the first sphere. This might be getting dazed, but the first sphere is so much better if it gets into play early that I think it's totally worth it over suspending a Riftbolt, which would be the other line. And now turn 2 with the lots of spells, we can cast a Lightning Bolt on a Delva or on another creature while being daze-proof, then suspend the Riftbolt to be daze-proof again. Maybe we don't even target the Delva, let's see, maybe they play a young Pyromancer or something like that. Okay, seems to be Ruck. So we could bolt the Goyf. Yeah, I think I'm definitely bolting the Goyf, and if they force it, so be it. Or maybe I attack first, hold on. Is there merit to attacking first? Because if they block the with the Goyf, I can Lightning Bolt them. Yeah, I think I'm attacking. And even if they have a counterspell, my Swiftspear still survives due to the Prowess trigger. And if they don't... well, I guess we have to bolt the Goyf there in this scenario too, because otherwise the Goyf will be a 2-3 because the bolt is my gravity. I think I'm just bolting the Goyf. Long story short, bolting the Goyf. And it worked, which is pretty good for us. So we suspend the Riftbolt because I think there's no reason to play into daze right now. And we put them down to 16, they have 4 cards in hand. They don't seem to have a force, which is good for us. Now they have daze. Okay. Okay, that's fine with me. Okay, they have a second Goyf. So, maybe that's the reason they didn't force 2. Yeah, do we want to hit the Delva or the Goyf? If we hit the Delva, we still have lots of time. And if we target them, then we have to be quick. And let's see, we can put them down to 10 by playing around daze, and then if we hit another land, I think we can afford to target the Delva here. buys us lots more time because the Golf can't or can attack us, of course, but can't be too confident because on the swing back the Swift Spear represents lots of damage. The question is this a good spot to play Price of Progress? What they could do is they could daze and fetch and fail to find, which means our Price of Progress only deals 2 points of damage. On the other hand, if that's their line, they waste their daze and we still do 2 damage and have 11 damage in hand, so I think, and they lose lands. So I think that might be worth it. We can also wait for them to maybe fetch end of turn and play the Price of Progress in their turn, which really doesn't change too much, I guess, because right now we're not playing around Flusterstorm or Spell Pierce, and in that case they can also don't cast Force of Negation. So I think my play here is to pass the turn, wait for them to crack, hope they don't have a wasteland, and fire up the Price of Progress and hoping for it to deal 4 or more damage. Yeah, that's also a fair line. But if they block, then Price of Progress, the Swift Spear is only a 4/5/2, right? Because it was a 2/3, gets 2 additional triggers. Do we want to Fire Blast in this case as well? I think that would have been a little bit too risky for my taste, because I think we still have enough time right now. Or do you hope that they don't block in this case, which I think they probably couldn't afford anyway at this life total if they... Well, maybe they could. Okay, that's fine if they attack here. Okay, so that's where I want to price, so we are... Yeah, I agree that sometimes you have to take gutsy lines, but in this case you're just trading Price of Progress for days, don't you? Because you don't kill the Tarmogoyf with their block, and that's a really bad trade, so I think the risk is pretty high, and like this way we have a realistic chance of resolving the Price of Progress, because they've shown us that they probably, or at least there's a tendency that they don't had Force a couple of turns ago, because they could have protected their Goyf. So I think this worked out better. Of course it is easy to say afterwards, but I think I'm confident that I would have taken this line anyway. So I think now we're in a pretty good spot. We have Lethal on board, and if they bolt here, for once they can't bolt right now. And yeah, we also have a couple of top decks here. And if they have double bolt, or what are they trying to do here? Is this Petty Theft? That could be. Yeah, Brazen Borer. Petty Theft it is. Okay, that's fine. So we know one of their cards in hand is Daze. We have Swift Sphere plus Fire Blast next turn, plus hopefully another burn spell, which means that if they don't have another creature right now, and they attack, we have lethal in different forms on the swing back. Brainstorm is fine. So we also don't know whether they still have days, because they might be thinking if we have four land, there's no much value in keeping days, but well, who knows. So, let's see. It's not over by any means, because if they have just a single forcible and we don't draw something nice from the top, the game can swing around really quickly, because we're taking four a turn, we might be taking seven soon. Like, if they attack, pass a turn, force our play, flash in Brazen Borer and Lightning Bolt us, we are dead next turn. So, even if you're at a seemingly comfortable life total of 12 right now, it doesn't have to stay that way. It can change pretty quickly. Always close games against those Rakdelver lists. Okay. They're thinking, which makes me a little more optimistic. This is an Uro. That would be okay. They're not thinking, they're just having trouble handling the Modo UI, as I often enough had myself. Okay, so we're taking four. I think we're fine here. So I think we just make them have it here, right? Because we are I think we are not dead in any case next turn. Because even if they draw a bolt, we can jump the Goyf. And if they don't have if they have Force of Negation, I'd rather get the last card in their hand as well. We still have three lands for Exiled Firecraft next turn. And yeah, let's see. Seems like they have force and still had days. Okay, so I think I can keep my land in hand and bluff whatever it is. And let's hope for a burn spell and them not having drawn a counter spell, otherwise we are pretty dead, I think. Because they attack for 3 and then attack us for at least 6 next turn. Unfortunately, they get another brainstorm. Which further, of course, increases their chances of hitting something. And I think we missed our window, or we might have missed our window because they've seen lots of cards. On the other hand, they're still pondering, so that might be a good sign, because if they had force and ponder, they probably wouldn't risk not finding another. Yeah, this on the other hand doesn't do too much. And yeah, we probably just die to something here. That's unfortunate. So we've drawn six lands this game. Yeah, probably just a little bit too much. I mean, we could still top deck in Firecraft and they didn't draw a bolt or didn't find a bolt in some way. That seems like a lightning bolt, yeah. Okay, so boarding against Delver. What do we want? I don't think we want the Roiling Vortex because it's a very clunky play. It takes us our life total as well, and if they have a free counter spell, they target the Roiling Vortex anyway. Claiming the Firstborn might be nice, especially against Goyf. I think Ensnaring Bridge on the play is a little bit too clunky for my taste. Do we have anything else we want to change? Price of Progress is great. Exploit Firecraft is great. Driftwood is great. Yeah, I think that's fine. Let's see. Yeah, I'll probably keep that. We have the Lightning Bolt for the turn one Delver, if needed. If they don't have the turn one Delver, I will probably don't play Lightning Bolt right now, or right away, I should say. We have Firecraft, we have Eidolons, multiples of those, which means I'm willing to play this in 2 days. I think in this matchup, you really also don't want to mulligan too aggressively, because in the end, it often comes down to some kind of resource battle, and especially on the play. Let's see, say if we mulligan and they daze our plays, we also have the opportunity with the three lands to play around daze in some capacity, so I think that's fine. On the draw, I think I would have mulliganed this because Eidolon is much, much worse on the draw. But on the play, let's say they ponder, we play Eidolon, they either daze or don't, and we are in kind of an okay spot. Land number four is pretty rough. I still think we can't really afford to play around daze too much because Eidolon gets really bad if we play it by turn four or something like that. It seems like a bolt. Yeah, that's totally fine if our Eidolon trades for a bolt and we have a second one. We didn't get dazed. But yeah. I think we are a little bit behind right now. They at least don't seem to have a turn to Goyf. Maybe they play a Delver, which is totally fine by me. We replay the Eidolon. We have some inevitability with our Firecraft, and yeah, let's see how it shakes out. Yeah, land number five is really rough. I think we just drew a little bit too many lands in the match. First, six in the first game, and five now. Probably, or at least the rule of thumb for burn is, yeah, of course, a very unrefined rule of thumb. If you draw your fifth land, then your game is not going too well, especially in the early game. And if you never draw your fifth land, burn is a really good deck. That's more true for modern even. Okay, yeah. I think since they seem to be stuck on one land and maybe also don't have the second bolt, well, scratch that. We might have a chance, but yeah. Screw beats Flood in the end in this scenario as well, and I don't have too much hope that we can get out of the situation too easily. No, this is game two, but we lost game one. So, okay, let's see. I still don't know whether they play Stifle or not, or whether they left Stifle in, so I don't want to suspend the Rift Bolt. The question is, do I want to hardcast the Rift Bolt right now? Which would play into a combination of Daze and Spell Pierce or Flusterstorm. But I guess I just don't have to. I think I just pass the turn and maybe then I will end of next turn start bolting them, playing around Force of Negation and different kinds of soft counters. Since they don't play any discards, you can really sculpt your hand as you wish. S At least kind of. Do they have Uro? That's a question. That would be bad. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, I guess if we, I didn't bring in any Graveyard Hate because I didn't see any Uros, even though the game went very long in game one, so I thought maybe they aren't on the Uro train. But what can you do? I also bought out Roiling Vortex, which of course would have helped in this game very much. So, if they play Uro next turn, we can Rift Bolt and Firecraft it. But it really doesn't do too much because they still have two cards and probably three with another fetch land in their graveyard. We are not too close to killing them. Drawing another land. I think we just have to hope to for them not to draw their fourth land because let's say they replay Uro, we use all our resources to kill it, and they have a handful of spells. I think what we have to do in order to have any chance of winning is targeting them and hoping for them not to hit their fourth land drop and for us to like hit a really good price of progress or something like that. I think I'm holding back Exfil Firecraft for now. I don't think there's much of a difference. And that way they don't know that they're on Virtual 7. Okay, Ponder is fine. So if we draw ex exactly Price of Progress and they don't have a way to deal with it, we might win. Okay, also Clothis, all the life gain. Okay, so let's see. Yeah, so I think we have to fire up the prize now because yeah, there's really no point in not and hoping that they either want to counter the last spell or I don't know. Yeah. Doesn't get much better than that, I think. Yeah, okay, Force of Negation, sure. And now it's getting out of reach pretty quickly, I think, because they're getting two a turn, and we really don't have cards in our 60 right now to, to keep up with that. Bring back Uro, sure. Okay, so that's pretty much it, I think. So if you have any questions towards the end of the stream, let me know. Otherwise, I will go through the motions here and probably end with the 3-2, which at the end, given that we met four Combidex, is a totally fine, fine result. And I'm pretty happy always if I go positive with Burn, it's totally okay. I don't expect much more than a 3-2 in general because you often meet some kind of combo deck or whatever, and yeah. Okay. So is there still a way if we shut down the Euro, closest little gains life? Yeah. But on the other hand, there's really also not a world where I can let the Uru live, right? Because so I'm sorry for the one person tuning in. This is the last match, and it's pretty much garbage time right now. We have flooded out a little bit against Ragdalva. They have Clothis. We don't have anything. They have an Uro they can soon bring back. Yeah. Well, I think I've seen enough. Thanks for tuning in, and well, we went 3-2 again. I think I'm not 100% positive. But I think on this stream at least, I never went worse than 3-2 with Vern, which is, given that by now we played a couple of leagues, pretty good showing for the deck, I think. S thanks for tuning in. Hi Kim and bye Kim. We're done for today. Yeah, nice to hang out with you. Even so spontaneously, and well, see you next time. Bye.